Hello friends, I am Ardhindo De and you are watching Eddie's English Literature. Today, we are going to read and understand William Shakespeare's women characters from his dramas, particularly Tragedies and Histories. In the wide gamut of William Shakespeare's dramaturgic articulation, the woman is itself a picture gallery, like that of Geoffrey Chaucer's Canterbury Tales. Here is God's Plenty. Shakespearean texts present diverse and conflicting views on the position of women, ranging from feminine leadership as the highest queen to limiting gender roles. The woman is in fact celebrated as the most powerful and the empowering force in some of Shakespearean texts. So let's begin our discussion on different categories. Striya charitram purushasya bhaggam devo na janati kuto manushaya. This sloka from Manusmriti, which means that no one can understand a woman's character and a man's destiny. This does not attempt to question a woman's character and belittle her, but to glorify the intricacy and mysteries of understanding a woman. Rather, the phrase is a glorification of womanhood. The great creator, the one great supreme lord who created this universe, of course, females included, certainly knows all the intricacies of his created universe. The God knows the created universe, and so does Shakespeare. The great manipulator of his puppet dramatic universe, whether the living, throbbing dolls are all male or female, the characters in front of us. Shakespeare, the maker, makes his women live according to the lights they receive from the magic lamp of their great creator, the dramatic Shakespeare. So, in the light of William Shakespeare's very puppetry, we can see the different catalogs of women character here. Now, here is the list of Shakespeare's women. The characters from his dramas and histories. Who is not there? Desdemona, Lady Macbeth, Rosalind, Ophelia, Portia, Cordelia, Viola, Emilia, Beatrice, Imogen, Juliet, Miranda, Gertrude, Beyonce, Goneril, Katrina, Kate, Minola, Hermia, Hippolyta, Volumenia, Psychorax, Jessica, Doll, Tearsheet, Partida, Rosalind Cufflet, Juliet's Nurse, Beyonce Minola, Mistress Quickly, Tinia, Regan, Lady Macduff, Three Witches. We cannot carry out a full-scale detailed analysis here, but we will definitely cover few major points. The women in Shakespeare's plays are vivid creations, each differing from the others. It is important to remember that in Shakespeare's time, boy actors played the female parts. So there had been no female actors at that time. Actresses did not appear in Shakespeare's play until after the restoration of Charles II to the English throne in 1660, and the introduction of French practices of dramas where women characters were involved. It says much about the talent of the boy actors of his own day that Shakespeare could have created such a rich array of fascinating women characters in his plays. So, in front of Shakespeare, there had been the boy actors, and he believed in their capability of acting, and he moduled those characters accordingly. Shakespeare was fond of portraying aggressive, witty heroines such as Kate of the taming of the shrew. Rosalind of Love's Lovers Lost, Rosalind in As You Like It, and Beatrice of Much Ado About Nothing. However, one thing it should be remembered that he was equally adept at creating gentle and innocent women characters, such as Ophelia in Hamlet, the princess, the would-be wife of Hamlet. Desdemona in Othello and Cordelia in King Lear is also soft-hearted characters. In fact, Shakespeare's female characters also include a kind of treacherous Goneril and Regan that we find in King Lear, the iron-willed Lady Macbeth, the witty and resourceful Portia in Merchant of Venice, the tender and loyal Juliet, and the alluring Cleopatra. So, the plenty of characters of different shades we can find out in Shakespeare's dramatic catalogues. Characters of women appearing in Shakespeare's plays from his earliest period show a marked difference from the approach of Marlowe. In some way, his master and to whom women were no more than dreams or trophies. So Shakespeare must have borrowed the characters, a few of the characters from his university wits, but there is a sea change of approaches in describing them. Critics have sometimes made too much of the individual differences, particularly among the comic heroines. They seem remarkable for their differences as well as for their similarities, whether they are Rosalind, Portia, Beatrice, or Viola. The hesitant Sylvia, the auburn-haired, grey-eyed daughter of the Duke of Milan in the Two Gentlemen of Verona, is a prelude to shy Portia in the Merchant of the Venice. The scene in the former play where Julia catalogues her lovers suggests a faint sketch of the dialogue between Portia and Nerissa in the letter. Thomas Pope, one notable Shakespearean producer of that time, remarked that every single character in Shakespeare had its own individuality and to an extent it is lively, and it is so that it is quite possible to identify the speaker with his or her speeches even if the names of the characters were not mentioned there. But it is exaggeration, and the exaggerating point that the Shakespeare is not such a extended genius, but despite the essential truth in it contains in Pope's words, it appears to be an overstatement. Men are men and women are women. The latter cannot talk like the former. There is something general about Shakespeare's women who were also drawn from life. Most of them are very practical and clear-sighted women. So notably, this like that of a panorama of life, panorama of the society in front of us. They are practical, clear-sighted, as I have told you. Lucette advises her mistress, Julia, not to dream or infancy. You can find in fancy the long winding thread in all's well that ends well is cut through at a blow by the countess. What does this nib here? Quickness of apprehension is almost a common quality with Shakespeare's women. In the final period, harmony, like voluminous, thinks it unbefitting to prate and talk for life and honor. Imogen answers the persecuting Clophane by reminding him apologetically that a lady's manners demanded lesser verbiage. Coriolanus addresses viril silence. Rosaline, Portia, Viola, despite sparkling wits and eloquence, are basically frank and simple creatures, not falling prey to their own verbiage. So, the characters that we find in Shakespearean's women catalogue is all too simple. Nothing so complex like that of male characters. In terms of practicality, Shakespeare's men do not stand any chance with his women. The men in Shakespeare's are generally thinking and imaginative a lot with their imagination, sometimes having a distinct disabling effect on them. Self-delusion in Shakespeare is more or less a masculine fault, and the whole debate is clearly summed up in the differences of attitudes between Macbeth and Lady Macbeth regarding the assassination of King Duncan. The lady knows too well the so-called scruples and dilatoriness in action. Initially, Lady was more in control than her husband. However, when she is deep into the action, she suffers hell till she acts in a frenzy to merge into ultimate oblivion. She is gone mad and committed suicide. Shakespeare's women are either good or bad, and they generally do not raise any fundamental questions. The middle ground of complexity and intricacy is reserved for the male characters. The women are kind of intuitive in nature, acting on instinct. Basically, they are simple. They are never eager to find a rationale of their actions. This only shows the depth and breadth of Shakespeare's knowledge of women. Celia in As You Like It is soft and tender and yet practical. She is very lightly drawn, yet when she cries out like a child in the forest at the sight of a blood-soaked handkerchief, a quality of innocence and simplicity in their nature is revealed in a few touches, convincing us of the dramatist's sure knowledge of the feminine heart. Shakespeare is no theorist propounding general laws of drama, and his women also are not just wit and courage. Their courage also fails, and even a Lady Macbeth dared not murder a Duncan because the king very much looked like her father. The childlike affections are not dead in the bosom of even that imperious lady. That Shakespeare is not always creating types is most abundantly shown in the creation of his Cleopatra. Shakespeare even differs from his sources Plutarch to endow his Cleopatra with a peculiar individuality, all her own. After all, she is Shakespeare's unparalleled lass. Shakespeare finally liberates himself from the tyranny of types when he creates his Ophelia, Desdemona, Cordelia. His art works now wonderfully and with less verbiage. None of them are types, and each of them is an offspring of the overpowering situation. Ophelia is a deserted maiden. Desdemona is a loyal wife. Cordelia is an affectionate daughter who ultimately protects her father. Our discussion would be fruitless if we miss Miranda, Sycorax from Shakespeare's Tempest, the witches from Macbeth, and the Dark Lady from his sonnets. I find Miranda Prospero a perfect daughter-father duo. Prospero's magic land as well as his zeal for life is represented by Miranda. Sycorax is no less feminine. She is powerful and right by her own ideology. The witches are mighty and deceitful, but they are strong in resolution. That's quite interesting. Again, the Dark Lady from his sonnets is bold and mysterious. Now, why is the Dark Lady in the discussion? In fact, I agree with Robert Browning that Shakespeare writes a kind of miniature drama in his sonnets. We can carry out the discussion further if time permits. But this little bit of introduction might help you in understanding Shakespeare's women characters from his dramas. So no more today in this discussion. Let me know what you think about Shakespeare's women characters in the comment section. Bye bye for now. Like, share, and obviously subscribe to my channel so that this can reach to the far audience. Bye bye. Thank you.